disbelief and horror and simple prayer for somebody to save the people who were inside that building is all anybody can do as an entire network is broadcasting live something so unimaginable. I have talked, as you all have, and as George Stephanopoulos reported, to the people who were inside as these scenes were taking place. We now see the first collapse, which of course took place about 10 a.m. Eastern time, and then it would be about 28 minutes later that we would see the second collapse of the second building. And while we're watching the scene, each person desperate, desperate to stop this tape and go and do something, all we can do is relive the horror each time we see it. I have talked to people who are inside the building, one of them Fran Martin, who is the aunt of someone who works here at ABC, and she was saying that the first experience inside the building was that earthquake-like feeling a number of people have mentioned. And then something else, in an eerie, silent, kind of mournful foliage, you saw paper just wafting out in all directions, and it was so mysterious to everyone. They couldn't imagine what had happened. The paper was scattering, and we've now read some 3 miles out, way across the river, the paper from those floors. As they came down the stairs, we're told that people were remarkably calm, were remarkably...
From Washington to Los Angeles. Just pause for a second. New information is coming in and information is being concerned. America...
Authority did a terrific job of evacuating the subways, even though they were filled with smoke, keeping people calm and keeping them actually in the station so that they wouldn't go out into the street as the soot was falling. One other word.
Around a corner, it got increasingly dark. The skies blackened as the material just continued to rain down. I hid briefly behind a car, and as the material got thicker and thicker and it became increasingly difficult to breathe, I got inside a parked car, a random parked car, and hid there basically until the material stopped falling. It was pitch black, black as night, inside that car, and for several minutes I remained there until some flickers of light were able to be seen. I made my way to a building and joined some police officers who were inside. And as the blackness began to lift and this gray, thick smoke clung in the air, we were able to find a police car.
In the United States of America, as horrible as these incidents are and as tragic as Oklahoma City was, the great strength of the nation, you know, is always there. I recognize that's one man's opinion and doesn't account for the individual shock of individual families or intelligence or military establishments, which have all suffered a grievous blow today in one way or the other. But it does say, I think, what people in most parts of the world believe, that as horrible as this is for the United States and its citizens, the United States continues to be unquestionably the leadership of the world and the example in the world of freedom and democracy, however much one may criticize it, ourselves included, on any given occasion or incident. It's interesting that in Oklahoma today, Governor Keating ordered all state office buildings closed, and the Oklahoma City Police created a one-block perimeter around the jail where Terry Nichols is housed. So again, you have an example of how people's minds work immediately. Was somebody going to try to spring Terry Nichols from jail, or was someone going to attack the jail in which Terry Nichols is housed? But in the wake of Oklahoma City and based on what's happened this morning, nobody should be surprised. And the Associated
Broadway up Nassau, and it was glass blown from everywhere.
When you were in your office when the first explosion occurred, that was the first building that was hit?
Yes, sir.
And were there lots of people in the building at that hour?
It was a good amount of people, but not lots.
It was not full to capacity?
No, thank God.
And were there other people who, so far as you could tell, were either seriously hurt or killed in the first explosion that you could find?
No, everybody I seen was mobile. They were able to get out the building. You know, people coughing, people fell on the stairs, They weren't hurt from the explosion. They were hurt trying to get out of the building.
Okay, Mr. Knowles, we wish you the very best, and by the grace of God, you were able to get out of there, and we know that this has been a difficult time for you, but we thank you for sharing your experience with us today.
Thank you.
I'm going to go to Washington now. Senator John McCain, who has declared this an act of war on the United States. It's already being described as a kind of 21st century Pearl Harbor. Senator McCain.
I think that's accurate in many respects, Tom, although clearly the implications of this are very significant, and including the fact that at least we knew who it was that took these actions against the United States at Pearl Harbor. And obviously at this point we don't know who it was or which organization or nation may have been sponsoring this kind of activity.
We're obviously in the early stages dealing still with the shock and the grief, trying to count the number of casualties, but this country will have to take immediate action in terms of how we rearrange ourselves now to hope that we don't have this happen again. We're going to have some profound changes in America, Senator.
Got to tell the hijacker that you're actually talking to headquarters. But that's as much as we know about one of the several aircraft today which were involved in attacks on the United States. Now, Diane Sawyer at Times Square has been trying, I know as best she can, to get some handle on casualties vis-a-vis the people are pouring into hospitals. Diane?
Right, Peter. Here's all I know, and it's kind of postscript to what John Miller was saying earlier. With Beekman Hospital, the closest hospital, as he said, has been relatively out of commission. But St. Vincent's Hospital, which is one of those in the next perimeter, 25 major hospitals in New York, this is one of the next closest, told us just minutes ago they had 184 hospitalized, two dead. Now, again, we know that these figures are going to be changing almost minute by minute, so this is very early. But at this time, and by now we're talking just minutes ago, 184 hospitalized, two dead. They said to us again, though, remember that where the World Trade Centers used to be, there is now a mountain of rubble. We are talking 200,000 tons of steel, 425,000 cubic yards of concrete, and 43,600 windows with all the glass in them now just lying on the ground. So the excavation has only begun, but 184 right now from St. Vincent's.
Thanks, Diane, very much. And I must tell you, I feel a little embarrassed about trying to focus on casualties in numerical terms only because it will ultimately give us some sense of the magnitude of this attack on top of the buildings themselves being brought to the ground, and similarly true at the Pentagon. So nobody feels gruesome or it's not about the gruesomeness of the casualty figures. It is simply trying to get some sense of the magnitude in human terms rather.
Pointed out something that we were not aware of, that because of when you have the two tremendous buildings, 110 stories high, both these buildings collapse, then there are buildings around these two twin towers that have collapsed.
Yeah, I was in one of them, 75 Barclay Street, and when the first tower collapsed, it created a tremendous smoke condition. It hit our building. We were trapped in our building for maybe 10, 15 minutes. So there are other buildings there that are affected by this. And
in an area rings 4, 5, and 6 on
there. In Pennsylvania. This is near Shanksville, Somerset County in western Pennsylvania, about 80 miles outside of Pittsburgh. David Mattingly, are you with us now?
Yes, Judy, I'm here. And we are outside of the town of Shanksville. And to give you some idea of what kind of countryside this is, to my left is a huge field of corn. To my right is a rolling green pastoral hill.
Dealt with in an integrated way. Tell me what that means, sir.
Well, it is obviously any organization that can plan such a coordinated attack within a very brief period of time must have substantial resources and must have a very capable organization and must have a haven where it is planning these things. You can't do that in a back room.
And when you talk about an integrated response...
Well, the integrated response is obviously... First of all, I want to say,
okay,
like every American right now, I'm behind the president. And this The response right now has been exactly what is needed. And there's the first necessity has to be to go through the tragedy to help the families and to clean up the immediate situation. Then the next step will have to be a program to attempt to eradicate the source of this and to bring pressure and serious pressure on governments that harbor this kind of organization, and especially governments where we suspect that these organizations are located.
Sir, for a long time, there's been a kind of cat and mouse game, and I don't make light of this in any sense when I say game, between the governments that harbor terrorists and our government, other Western governments. It's all changed today, hasn't it? I mean, the stakes have changed enormously. The response likely will change enormously. It's all different, isn't it?
That's correct. When these terrorists dare to attack the territory of the United States, it then becomes a question of the functioning of our society. And we have to protect ourselves.
That went into the Pentagon.
Okay, thanks very much. So what we have now in terms of the trade towers, we have one American Airlines aircraft, one United Airlines aircraft, which hit the two trade towers. We have a second American Airlines aircraft, which goes into the Pentagon. And we have a third aircraft, United Airlines, which we have no idea about either whether it was on a mission or for what reason it crashed, crashing southeast of Pittsburgh today. But three major aircraft today carrying considerable numbers of passengers and crew on board are all down, at least three of which appear to have been involved in a coordinated attack on the United States. I should also tell you that abcnews.com plays an important role in our life all the time, but it's very important at a moment like this, and has a good many offerings up at the moment, including the continuous reporting of the work we're doing here on television and they're doing on their own. There's a reader messenger board up there, as always, and that's...
This is an A-mate. 20,000 or more people may have been inside the two 110-story buildings at the time of the attacks. Eyewitnesses report victims falling, and in some cases, jumping from the two buildings. At approximately 9:40 a.m., in Washington, D.C., a third hijacked plane crashes into the Pentagon in a burst of flames, one side of the building collapsing. Non-essential personnel from federal buildings, including the White House and the U.S. Capitol, are evacuated. 9:59 a.m., the South Tower of the World Trade Center collapses, an unknown number of people still trapped inside. 1.5 hour later, at approximately 10:28 a.m., the North Tower of the World Trade Center collapses. Rubble, debris, spreading for blocks. In a separate but apparently related crash, a fourth hijacked plane, a Boeing 767, crashes in western Pennsylvania, about 80 miles.
Massachusetts, and went down into the Albany area, actually up in the Adirondacks. It took a sharp dogleg. What's interesting about this flight is everything seemed to be normal. Flight at the altitude was about 29,000 feet. Gaining speed at about 450 knots. It took that sharp dogleg down across the Adirondacks straight for New York. Now, what will be interesting about this as this story unfolds will be, number one, listening to any air traffic control conversations to get a sense of what, if anything, air traffic controllers were saying to this aircraft. Undoubtedly, this was spotted on the radar screens, of course. They had quite a bit of time to watch this plane as it went down toward New York. That's probably at least a 30-minute run there. And during the course of that time, those air traffic controllers and those radar installations, New York Center, as it is called, would have been trying to contact American Airlines Flight 11 to indicate its intentions. It must have been a horrifying scene for them. They were probably trying to clear air traffic out of the area. Clearly, once those tapes become available, we'll have a little bit more knowledge, and if it is possible to locate any of the so-called black boxes, the flight data recorders, cockpit voice recorder, out of this particular aircraft, they'll obviously know more about what was going on what must have been a very dramatic flight indeed. Now, this is the first flight. This is the flight that first impacted the first tower of the World Trade Center, and this is the first of four that we know about, of course, four air hijackings, which led to crashes and obviously a tremendous amount of damage. I'm getting this information from a company called FlightExplorer.com. They are compiling their archival radar information from this morning, and as it becomes available, we'll be able to show you the flight paths of the other.
United Flight 175, also from Boston to Los Angeles, it too crashing into the World Trade Center, the second tower. The next explosion occurred at 9:38.
Certain about did not know why it had crashed, whether it was part of this overall operation this morning. The AP is now quoting a man who minutes earlier, saying he was a passenger on the plane, told an emergency dispatcher in a cell phone call that we are being hijacked. We are being hijacked. Treat that as you do all the information we give you today as being preliminary at best, sometimes wrong. I think we've been pretty good about it today, and certainly confused, because listening to the mayor, listening to the governor of the state, both of whom we talked to, listening to the senator in charge of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, listening to all of our analysts, listening to everybody, the country is still very much in the middle of, if not immediate post event chaos, certainly in terms of trauma and trying to get a handle on what the hell's been going on here. And as we've said before, when you look at the television pictures of the Trade Center collapsed upon itself, these are buildings 110 stories high, and where thousands and thousands and thousands of people work. And I know on occasion we can run the images of it to the point of offensiveness. I hope we're not there, but this is what it looked like when one of the trade towers just appeared to either peel away or collapse on itself, but from top to bottom, 110 stories to the bottom. First one, the southern tower, tower one or tower two, it doesn't matter what, just one tower and then the other, and then the other tower sometime later, which John Miller said the cops picked up very quickly. It was looking weak and bending or leaning in one particular direction, indicating that when those two aircraft, one hitting one tower, the other hitting another, had gone straight into those towers with such force that even at the midpoint of the building, or in that case two-thirds up, something had happened to so totally weaken the infrastructure that this was like peeling a banana, except that it was full of people, or had many, many people in it. I think we have Senator John McCain on the phone from Washington. Am I right, Senator?
Yes, Peter. How are you?
I'm well, sir. Thank you. I'm not well. None of us are well. You know that.
Yes.
What's on your mind?
Well, I think that this act, obviously, is one which would constitute an act of war. I believe that the American people should remain calm and rally behind our president, and I am confident that our military and our president we'll find out the perpetrators of this outrage, and we will not only punish those responsible, but ensure that something like this never happens again. And clearly, we need to look at our intelligence capabilities.
I don't mean for one second, Senator, to belittle the necessary thing you must say today, which is we'll find those who are responsible and we'll punish them, because Tony Cordesman has just pointed out very effectively how often we don't find the people and we don't get to punish them. But you say it an act of war.
Yes.
Do you believe that if another country is somehow the patron of an individual or a group of individuals who has done this, we should go to war with that country?
Absolutely, because they have committed atrocity on a scale that's unprecedented in history that I know of. Everybody's talking about a second Pearl Harbor. At least that was an attack on military targets, not on the civilian community. This is an unspeakable outrage. And clearly, we can and must find out who perpetrated it. And Tony Cordesman and I have great respect for him, but I believe that we have the capability to find it out. And we need to improve our intelligence capabilities, particularly in the area of human intelligence. We have wonderful satellite capabilities, had technical capabilities. In the late 70s and early 80s, we, for all intents and purposes, dismantled our inhuman intelligence capability, which divines motives, and that's something technical intelligence cannot do.
Well, I think those of us who cover intelligence in any way, Senator, know that human intelligence, or HUMINT as they call it in the trade, has been very difficult, particularly in places like Afghanistan. So just assume for a second, well, no, don't assume anything, but are you desperately frustrated at the moment in some respects because this was sort of, in many ways, this was bound to happen in some measure, and we may not be able to get at the perpetrators?
No, I think that among many other things, obviously sorrow is the overriding emotion, but also I don't think our lives will ever be the same again in some respect, especially those who use airliners with some frequency. There's always been questions and studies and tests of our airport security systems, and they've always found breaches in them. Obviously, that's going to have to be addressed, and that's going to be very inconvenient for Americans. But at the same time, we also have to reevaluate the importance of making sure that anyone who wants to try it is incapable of doing so. But the best way to address it, obviously, is going to the source.
Your Democratic colleague, Senator Biden, said a while ago, the terrorist wins again when it alters American lifestyle. I assume you believe the same thing.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And the things that have been inflicted on the American people it staggers the imagination. And yet I believe that the best thing that we can do as Americans is remain calm, rally behind the President of the United States, and know with confidence that we will take whatever steps are necessary to prevent this from happening again. I don't think that there's any reason for Americans to feel a sense of panic.
Okay. Thank you, Senator McCain, very much indeed. Appreciate your time. Senator John McCain of Arizona, who knows a lot about violence, and many people in the country will think knows a lot about leadership as well. Former presidential candidate, often talking about doing it, or often considered to be doing it again. Claire Shipman is in Washington. Claire, where's Mr. Bush?
Well, Peter, we have a little bit of news on that front. As you know, he is in the air again on his way somewhere from Shreveport, Louisiana. We have been told by sources that he will not be coming to Washington. He is going to make another stop at an undisclosed secure location so that he can talk to people from there on the ground. His security team can assess just how safe it is back here in Washington. As you mentioned earlier, that there must be great political pressure for him to get back to Washington. These sources confirm just that. The political team wants him back home. He wants to come back home. His security team does not feel it is safe right now. They do think, though, and they're guessing right now, that he might be able to get back at some point this evening. But again, he's got at least one more stop. Another interesting point along those lines.
One more stop?
One more stop between Shreveport and Washington. He's on his way now, we're told, to another undisclosed location that his security team considers secure. They won't tell us where it is, obviously.
But do we know? So, in other words, this one more stop is another security stop dictated by the Secret Service?
A new device that we're using, and there is always a delay. Tends to be a delay in audio. I want to bring in now our national security correspondent, David Ensor. You're looking at pictures as I do this from New York City in the moments following the worst of today's attacks on the World Trade Center in New York City, Lower Manhattan, where you can see people running in sheer terror away from either one of the two airplane crashes into the top of the World Trade Center, both towers of which collapsed later on, to the utter horror of people watching both live and on television across the United States and around the world, for that matter. New York City, the subject of the worst terrorism ever to strike the United States. So while we certainly mourn the loss here in Washington at the Pentagon, the airplane that crashed into the Pentagon, the other airplane that crashed near Pittsburgh, both of them commercial airliners with civilians on board, the loss of life in New York City is utterly unbelievable. And just picking up as we look at these pictures, picking up on what Nick Robertson was saying from Afghanistan, even as the leaders of the Taliban deny any role in this, an Arab journalist based in London is quoted today to the Associated Press as saying that followers of Osama bin Laden warned 3 weeks ago they were going to carry out this sort of an attack. New York City Mayor Rudolph Giuliani joining us once again. Mayor Giuliani.
The tragedy that we're all undergoing right now.
We want to tell you what we know as we know it. We just got a report in that there's been some sort of explosion at
the first thing any television camera saw this morning was this. Just before 9 o'clock, roughly 15 minutes earlier, an American Airlines jet hijacked from Boston had crashed into the South Tower of the World Trade Center. There were 92 people on board.
It does not appear that there's any kind of an effort up there yet. Now remember, oh my God.
That looks like a second plane.
Minutes later, the second plane, the second tower. The fireball ate up the aircraft. It was a United Airlines flight, a 767 from Boston to Los Angeles. There had been 65 people on board.
I was happened to look on the first tower, and I actually saw people waving where the first plane crashed through, and then it was unbelievable seeing this second jet come crashing into the second tower. What is going on?
New York City was staggered.
As soon as you got hit, I was thrown to a window. So I was very lucky.
We're going to interrupt this. We'll come back to this, I promise you, to go to a news conference being held by the mayor of New York, Rudolph Giuliani.
And then, Governor?
On the number of casualties, the effort now has to be to save as many people as possible.
There are large numbers.
And I don't think we will know the answer to that until sometime tomorrow or the next
day. Were there large numbers of firefighters?
There are a large number of firefighters and police officers who are in harm's way, and we don't know how many we've lost. But there's no doubt we've lost some firefighters and police officers.
Do you know anything about the cause of the explosions that brought the two buildings down yet? Was it caused by the planes or by something else?
We believe that it was caused by the after effects of the planes hitting the buildings. We don't know of an additional explosion after that, but we have no specific information to that effect. Obviously, the city is now closed. The airspace around the city is closed, and we are on heightened alert. But we have no specific information suggesting any further attack.
Mayor, why are two major warships coming into New York?
I think to give the people of New York confidence, to show that the federal government is standing with us, and to just to make certain that nothing further happens. This has been a very, very difficult and traumatic day for the people of the United States and the people of the city. And I think that it's an act that shows that the federal government is going to do everything they can to support us and help us.
Can you give an idea of the extent of the rescue effort that's going on right now in Long Island, the scope of this thing, of this operation?
There are over 1,000 rescue workers, probably about 2,000 that are deployed, trying to get into the buildings, trying to find people, trying to search for people. The governor and I spoke a couple of hours ago. The governor has deployed the National Guard to relieve them because our people are going to need reinforcements pretty soon, but right now they don't want to leave because they're searching for innocent citizens, and they're searching for some of their
upside area. They won't be patrolling the rest of the nation.
No, the purpose of it is to help with the relief effort. We're gonna need the help of the state, surrounding areas with heavy duty equipment.
When will they be arriving?
National Guard troops, some have arrived already, and we expect to have the up to close to 2,000 between the National Guard and the state police by later this evening.
Mayor, bridges and tunnels will have to stay closed indefinitely.
I think everything is closed for now, and then maybe in about an hour or two we can give you an update on what the plan will be for tomorrow.
We saw a lot of lightly injured people walking out of the area because obviously the emergency services were needed for the very seriously injured. People come with dust, some people had difficulty breathing. Is there any health advice that to give to people who are caught in this thing, who are not necessarily at risk of losing their life, but
I think obviously if you feel ill or you feel that you've been affected by it, you should go to a hospital and get checked out. But if it's just discomfort that you feel, then you can do basically what we did, was to wash our faces off and get rid of the clothes and get to an area where you can breathe in fresh air.
How many people were in the World Trade Center at the time of this attack?
I mean, business had already started. It was
so what's normal
right before 9 o'clock. I don't know.
Did you
I don't
tens
know.
Tens of thousands?
Yes. Approximately. Someone just gave me a number of approximately 10,000, but that's a guess.
How long will the city remain on a heightened state of alert?
Until we're told not to. I mean, until the FBI and the police department and the federal government tells us that we shouldn't. Right now, the city is on should be on a state of alert. Now, that instead of frightening people, that should make people feel more confident that everything is being done to keep things secure. And again, let me emphasize that the reason for the National Guard, because I heard the question before, is to help with the relief effort, not because there's any fear of any other problems in the city right now.
How is the Port Authority
City Hall, Mount Police Plaza? When will it be safe for you to return?
I don't know yet. Hopefully soon, but I don't know the answer to that.
And we heard reports that Mount Police Plaza was evacuated. Was that true?
No, the command center is open.
And it was never.
We have people in the command center right now.
There has also been reports of large loss of life among the police and firemen who were sent there to rescue people. How accurate are those reports? There is no question that we lost police officers and firefighters, and some that I know personally, and all of us here know personally, that we're very worried about. And we're not going to know the answer to that until much later. And maybe we should just close now and give you a briefing later. And I would just ask everyone, I talked to Cardinal Egan before because he's at St. Vincent's Hospital. Everybody should in their own way say a prayer and ask God for help and for assistance and also ask God to give us the strength to overcome this, because I know we're going to need strength to overcome it. And I want the people of New York to be an example to the rest of the country and the rest of the world that terrorism can't stop us. American democracy is much stronger than a vicious, cowardly terrorist, and we're going to overcome this.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well
done, Mayor. New York Mayor Rudolph Giuliani and New York Governor George Pataki talking to reporters. The mayor urged New Yorkers to be calm and said they had been, and indeed in every picture.
Center, the workday was well underway there in Lower Manhattan, an airliner crashing into one of the twin towers of the Trade Center. The people in New York, and then very quickly, people all around the nation watching just terrible horror as a thick black smoke billowed from the tower. But that, as it turned out, as it proved, was really just the beginning. 18 minutes later, just 18 minutes later, you see in the highlighted picture there on the right side, another very big commercial jumbo jet moving towards the other tower of the World Trade Center. And there you see again the explosion taking place on camera for all to see, quite apparently, quite specifically designed to do that. That was at 9:03 Eastern. Cameras were trained on the two twin centers. Of course, you know that the Trade Center was the target of a terror bombing back in 1993, which killed 6 people. The attack injured so many more, and it really does pale in comparison to what we are seeing today. Although, as you just heard from the mayor of the city of New York, nobody wants to make a guess yet on what the final toll will be. In the middle of all of this, suddenly Washington became a target. You see it here. This is the Pentagon, which we always view as some sort of an impenetrable fortress. Pentagon, the symbol of the nation's military might, also a command post today. Pentagon wrecked by the explosion that occurred at 9:45 this morning. Witnesses say that the commercial aircraft crashed into the Army side of the building. That has been confirmed by authorities. It's about this time that the federal government ordered all the nation's airports closed and ordered all planes in the air to get on the ground. And as you just heard from Aaron Brown, aircraft will not be. That was the visual sighting. You see really just almost an explosion, an implosion, as it just gave away all that was left, the ash falling from the top of the tower as it came down. 29 minutes later, the second Trade Center tower collapsing. We can report that we know some 50,000 people work daily in the area of the Trade Center buildings. These towers are U.S. landmarks. They receive tens of thousands of visitors each day. The mayor of New York City has said that he does believe a horrendous.
Where were you?
I was in the 99th floor.
In the two building.
In the two building. Was that was the first one hit?
No, the one building was hit first.
Right.
And then after the all building got hit.
When the first one got hit and you were just next door, what did you think?
I got so scared that my heart started beating so fast that I just, everybody in our department just ran down the stairs.
Who did you work for?
ANR Services of New York. It's an insurance company.
And were you able to get all the way down 99 floors and out of the building before your building was hit as well?
No, we was on the 65th floor when our building got hit.
And what happened then? Were you in the stairwell?
Yes, we was in the staircase. Yes, we was.
And what did you think when the building got hit?
Oh, my gosh. Everybody got scared. We were all praying to God that we would make it out in time. We were all praying. And we just kept moving. We just kept running down the stairs. So we got out, like, in a nick of time.
And was it terribly crowded, and was there smoke?
Yes, it was. Oh, yes, it
and
was.
Water in the stairwell as well from the sprinklers?
Well, I didn't see no water because we were just running down the stairs, the staircase was packed with people. We were just running down the stairs.
And when you got down and got out, what did you do then?
Well, they told us, that they showed us exactly where to walk, so I was in Fulton Street. And then a few minutes later, we just started running because the whole building collapsed after that. The whole building just came right down. So, and the smoke was so intense that we was running. We ran all the way to the Brooklyn Bridge just to get away from the smoke.
And what did you think when you turned around and saw the building coming down?
I said, oh, my God, all those people in there. We were screaming. Everybody that was in there, we were screaming, oh, my God, oh, my God, oh, my God. We made it up, but all those people in there, we was crying. All those people in there. You know, it shook us up so bad. It shook us up.
What about your friends and the people that you know that work in the building? Were they all able to get out, Amy?
Well, the people in my department, I think everyone made it all safe, but I don't know about the rest of them. I'm worried about them because I don't know if they made it safe or if they died or what. I don't even know.
Where are you now?
There's really no communication with anybody else for 3 or 4 minutes. And
right.
Inside the building, it was certainly calmer, but again, people were panicked there as well.
All right, thank you very much. CNBC's Ron Insana. In the Middle East today, the Israeli Foreign Minister Shimon Peres was scheduled to meet. Yasser Arafat has condemned this attack.
As a matter of fact, they're already on their way. You know, all of us feel today like being an American. Your pain is our pain, and we can imagine what's going over in the country. But it is the United States, again, that can again save the humanity, one of the greatest dangers to civilization, to our future. It's an attempt to bring us in a jungle where people will not be able to walk or to fly or to feel free. And I think there are ways and means to handle this challenge. And there is nobody better equipped, in spite of all the agonies, than the United States to lead again the world to become a more civilized and safer place.
Mr. Peres, there are going to be so many people who are worried that this act of war, and it is nothing less than this, on the United States, will only have a polarizing effect, that it will not be in any way a means to get countries together and right-thinking people in all of the world, including in your very volatile part of the world, to come to some common agreement against terrorism.
I don't think so. I think that the ones among the Arabs who are engaged in terror will today understand that this is the end of the story. They cannot go ahead with it. And I think the world has to get itself organized with the leadership of the United States to identify countries or organizations which are hosting or supporting or financing this terrible form of terror. I think also leaders, religious leaders, spiritual leaders, newspaper men, political figures have to condemn with the full heart the appearance of suicidal murders, which really caused the same damage like in Pearl Harbor. They shouldn't be permitted. It's against the gospel. It's against everything we stand for. And I see it as a world struggle that concerns each of us individually, and I believe we can manage and handle it, no matter if you're an Arab or a Jew or an American.
And what about the conduct of the Israeli government in its continuing conflict with the PLO and with Yasser Arafat? Is that going to be changed as a result of all of this?
That's my hope. We are telling today the Arabs and the Palestinians, look, today it's the chance to depart from terror completely and fully and go back to the district of negotiations, of understanding. Nothing will be solved by weapons and killings, and everything that was solved in the past and may be solved in the future is around the negotiating table.
Have you had any contact with Chairman Arafat today or with his representatives?
What I'm telling you, we let them know as well.
Has there been any rescheduling of the meeting?
And is now used for recreational purposes. There are tennis courts and golf driving ranges and other things there, meeting rooms, that kind of thing. It's a commercial operation. But a triage center has been set up there, and 50 makeshift operating rooms are being prepped, and hundreds of ambulances are there waiting to take injured away from that facility. But they are doing treatment of people right on the site or nearby at Chelsea Piers. Reports from some of the hospitals that are taking the injured. St. Vincent's Hospital here in New York, the numbers again very rough, but an estimate of over 200 that have been taken in there. Three dead, 18 in critical condition, and the most chilling quote that you can hear, Dr. Stephen Stern there at St. Vincent's Hospital quoted as saying, hundreds of people coming in have been burned from head to toe. Bellevue Hospital reporting more than 100 patients brought in, two dead. Beth Israel reporting earlier that 70 patients had been brought in. There are some estimates from hospitals in Virginia near the Pentagon of dozens of people having been brought in there. And the heartening note in all this, hospitals around New York that are not in the immediate vicinity of the World Trade Centers, people saying hundreds of donors are reportedly lined up to give blood outside Beth Israel Medical Center and some others here in New York City. And what I guess is a precursor of what is going to be the kinds of terrible news that we're going to get over the next few days. A spokesman at the medical examiner's office in New York City, the coroner's office, says that for now all of the bodies that are being brought in, dead bodies, will go to the medical examiner's office on First Avenue here in New York. They say they have room for several hundred bodies, and they are making room for more space since they anticipate more bodies will be brought in. One other note to mention, at 4:30 this afternoon Eastern Time, the FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, says that it has activated all 10 of FEMA's regional headquarters around the country, including those on the East Coast and then all the way west as far as San Francisco and the state of Washington. They have activated all of those regional headquarters, activated the Federal Response Plan, which FEMA says brings together 28 federal agencies and the American Red Cross, and 12 urban search and rescue teams are being dispatched. Eight of them are being sent here to New York and four to Washington, all deployed to search for victims of what has happened today. And the Health and Human Services Department has activated a national medical emergency system. It's really an unprecedented move, but it could dispatch nearly 7,000 volunteer doctors, nurses, pharmacists, other medical staff to areas that have been affected by today's attacks. So that brings you up somewhat to date on what's being done in terms of those who have been injured and provisions now being made for those who've been killed today. Peter?
Thank you, Charlie, very much. Try to keep the sort of sense or the proportion of casualties into some kind of perspective. The gentleman with whom we've just been talking, who worked in a law firm in the Northern Tower, said that after the first aircraft hit in that tower, which is 8:48 Eastern time. This is one of those "where were you when" moments. I'm just utterly convinced will be that way in historical terms. Where were you when the first aircraft and then the second aircraft crashed or were crashed into the Twin Trade Towers in New York City on this day, the 11th of the month? And there's a timeline. If it's 8 hours now since this happened, and where Mayor Giuliani speaks just a few minutes ago. They know of 2,100 people in
toward the tip of the island and seeing very few people, no traffic, the smoke continuing to billow from these buildings, and nothing where there were once these two landmarks that drew everyone's attention, whether you drove or flew or came to New York by boat. But Peter, there is a new concern, according to authorities, at this moment here in Lower Manhattan, and that is the growing fear that another building in the World Trade Center complex, which was not struck by an airplane, is in danger of collapsing. That is number 7 World Trade Center, somewhat shorter, somewhat with somewhat fewer stories than numbers 1 and 2. There is a fire burning vigorously in the lower floors of that building, threatening the foundation. And the building was already damaged some 6 hours ago now when the North Tower collapsed, and part of that process of the building collapsing struck and damaged number 7 World Trade Center. So it's already was already at some risk before this fire grew as vigorously as it has. The authorities have now moved people several blocks away from that building, and we're just watching and waiting to see what happens.
Bob, is number 7 World Trade Center, and I see you've now managed to come down to the ground, which suggests things loosen up a little bit. Is that where the mayor's emergency headquarters are?
Peter, I honestly don't know, but I will tell you that number 7 is just behind number 2. I'm in Tribeca now, and you're seeing mostly smoke from the remnants of number 1 and number 2, but there, somewhere in that smoke, is number 7.
I don't know how big number 7, the World Trade Center, is. My recollection is a fairly low building, isn't it? Yes,
I would guess, and I'm sorry to have to...
Okay. We're talking about state, actual states.
I think the states, I mean, you know, the famous remark, round up the usual suspects. The usual suspects, we've tended to look at Iran. Iran was involved in a trail of terror, but the Iranians have exited out of that industry a while ago. The Iraqis, I mean, we are always talking about Iraq, and the Bush administration came in talking even about unseating Saddam Hussein, that they didn't really want to live with Saddam Hussein like the Clinton administration, but they want to overthrow Saddam Hussein. So is Iraq a state to worry about? I think in this case, if we really, the Taliban regime in Afghanistan must be really the one to worry about and must be the one to, in many ways, focus on, because they are the ones who harbor Osama bin Laden and give him shelter and sanctuary. And the last time that we accused them of harboring bin Laden, they didn't really pay a terrible price for it. So obviously this is a very different question. But the states we're talking about, I mean, would the Syrians do it? Unlikely.
Libyans?
Well, the Libyans, you know, the last time we talked about the Libyans, you may recall, was like something like 15 years ago, that the Libyans were active in the world, and then they took time out after the attack on them by the Reagan administration in 1986. And after that, Gaddafi somehow dropped off the radar screen. So I'm not sure states would involve themselves in
North
this
Korea?
That's an interesting question. And I think, again, I mean, I actually personally, just if I were to make a wild guess and just, I don't think we're really dealing with states. We're dealing with something beneath the level of states.
Some kind of worldwide terrorist networking.
Yes.
That isn't to say that they pick up the phone and talk with each other every day, that you can connect the dots, but what would make something below state-sponsored terrorism very effective, maybe they get money from some state or what have you, but the less they say to one another, the less they communicate, the more effective they can be.
Yes. Absolutely.
Fuad Ajami. Now, in New York at the moment, the situations in most hospitals are beginning to stabilize somewhat. Hospitals in the immediate area of the World Trade Center were overwhelmed in the early going. It's fair to say that they're still overwhelmed, but the situation is beginning to stabilize somewhat. I want to say again that the American Red Cross has kept open in most sections of
of New York City, those stations where you can go to give blood, and there has been an anticipated shortage of blood. Blood supplies were already short, and on a nationwide basis, including New York. So just a note that if you're saying to yourself, what can I do? One of the things you can do is give blood, and the American Red Cross is one of those places you can contact to do
that. They've been going after even some of those that are connected to Palestinian or Hamas leaders in Palestine. Now, the other part is, of course, there's dissatisfaction, even according to polls and leaders in Europe, about the whole issue of national missile defense, about...
But you're not saying that dissatisfaction missile defense would lead to someone... someone from Northern Europe to hijack planes and attack us, are you?
John, all the markings are that this is a fundamental Islamist circumstance where you have hundreds of Islamic groups, and many of which are very radical, but as some previous guests have indicated, they don't necessarily have the money, they don't have the wherewithal, as you pointed out, John, on 757 flights. You know, it takes the deep pockets of Osama bin Laden and the cooperation, perhaps internally within the U.S., of sympathetic organizations that could provide the mechanism. But the security of our airports is seriously in jeopardy here, because obviously at least four breaches, significant breaches of that security have taken place enable this to take place.
Colonel McGinnis, hang on just a second. I should tell everybody that as we watch these pictures and discuss this and what happened, that President Bush is in the air from Offutt Air Force Base near Omaha and is on his way back to Washington. And he will address the nation tonight. We do not have an exact time, but when the president is back on the ground in Washington, he is going to address the nation about today's four terrible terrorist attacks, three of which actually struck the targets that they were intended. One of them, the hijacking that wound up in a crash in Pennsylvania, evidently did not get the intended target, although we're not certain what that target might have been. Maybe Camp David, maybe the Capitol, maybe the White House itself. It ended up in Pennsylvania in a crash. Meanwhile, two planes struck World Trade Center, one more struck the Pentagon. We now have to figure out how those planes were hijacked, how they were piloted, who did it, why, and what we do about it as a nation.
We are due to have some more information literally in the next couple of minutes from American Airlines and United Airlines.
It's kind of close for that to be here now and then realize what happened.
Yeah.
And
we'll run this again because I think this is, can we run that again, Roger Goodman? That's Roger Goodman, our director, because this is, we've seen footage before of people on the run, and I understand that that's your shadow as you went by a storefront.
Yeah, actually,
right?
It was. It's the first time I've seen that.
And was there absolute panic immediately?
Instantly. It was just pandemonium. Nobody knew what to do. There was no clear thinking. People were just reacting to kind of save themselves and the people around them.
And this is such a moment. You're in the same location when the building comes down.
I had been taken downstairs by Port Authority police who knew that I had this videotape. And we were moving actually to go back to the Trinity Church to make them a dub of the tape in a format that they could use on a VHS tape. And suddenly I heard one of the guys say, "Hey, Evan, watch out."
Hang on just a second. If you look in the upper, look, this now is frozen. This is an angle of this attack that we have not seen before. At the top of the building on your left, out of the left, will come the building. And watch how the aircraft penetrates the building. Go ahead. Completely in one side and out the other.
It just disappeared. It disappeared like a bad special effect. It disappeared right into the building. I've seen it 6-7 times now. It's still incomprehensible what is actually happening there. You're right. As a journalist, you have to take yourself away from it, and I'm still not there yet. And the more and more I see it, and as time goes by,
the modern technology enables us to see horror just as we are able to see sport in a variety of different speeds or at a variety of different speeds. And I think you now have a better appreciation than we have had up until now, for which we thank you, Evan, because we see exactly how determined somebody was to do this horrible damage, taking a plane so powerfully and so fast in one side of the other.
terrorist attacks rock New York
centers, maybe the big picture wasn't analyzed.
Miles O'Brien, our correspondent, thanks very much for your insight into all this. Now we return to Aaron Brown up in New York. Aaron.
Joey Miles, thank you.
She called her husband twice during the hijacking to tell him the plane had been hijacked, and they lost contact once, and she called back. After the first call, Olson called the command center at the Justice Department to inform them of this hijacking, and they said they knew nothing about it but would track it down. Barbara Olson told Ted the following story, that all the passengers were herded to the back of the plane, including the flight personnel, including the pilot. And the only weapons she mentioned were knives and cardboard cutters. You would think if there were a machine gun or any other kind of gun that she would have mentioned that. But the only weapons she mentioned were knives and cardboard cutters. I asked Ted if she made any reference to nationality of the hijackers or any suspicions about the motive. And he said she made no reference to that at all. They didn't have a whole lot of time to talk. She said to Ted, "What do I tell the pilot to do?" Somewhat typical of Barbara, a take charge kind of person. But there was nothing they could do. And they're all trapped in the back of the plane.
Did she, or was she able to tell Mr. Olson how many hijackers were on board the plane? Or at least how many she may have seen?
I asked Ted that. No, but she referred to them as more than one. More than one. Incidentally, she wasn't even supposed to be on this flight. She was booked on a flight yesterday, but today is Ted's birthday, so she wanted to be here this morning to have breakfast with him before she left.
And
that story.
It's a horrible story, and one can only assume that it is one of many horrible stories that we will hear in the hours ahead. Sure. It says something about the world we live in that people, while this was going on, were able to make cell phone calls. We heard earlier today of another call that was made from a plane, that there was some awareness on the ground, perhaps not formal awareness, but some awareness of what was going on, at least on some of those, on some of those planes. Mr. Olson must be devastated.
Well, you can imagine. He's surrounded by friends, but this is tough for everybody. It's tough for the country, but it's particularly tough for the loved ones.
It is indeed. Tim, thank you for your efforts.
Sure.
Thank you for your efforts today. We appreciate that. Again, Barbara Olson, one of the 200-plus passengers on four different airliners, and we have no reason to believe that any of those people survived the crashes today here in New York, in Pennsylvania, outside of Pittsburgh, and at the Pentagon in Washington. We still do not have a very good feel, to be perfectly honest, for how many people have died today. We have no particular feel, to be perfectly honest, how many people have been injured. We can only surmise that we are talking in the hundreds, the thousands of people certainly have been injured today. How many of those will survive, we do not yet know. Judy?
And Aaron, this may be another point where we want to say God bless the souls of those who have lost their lives today or who are dying as we speak in hospitals and in places where they cannot be reached. I think even those out there who may not believe that there is a God, at a time like this, we all reach out for a higher being, and we want to believe that there is someone who can bring us salvation. Jamie McIntyre at the Pentagon, questions today about the whereabouts of some of the top people in government in the United States. We've known the president's been flying around the country. The vice president's been out of sight. The Secretary of Defense, Mr. Rumsfeld, has also been out of sight. What can you tell us about him,
well,
and what else is going on there?
A short time ago, he did come out and inspect the damage here at the Pentagon, along with the vice chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Richard Myers. We're so far away, though, we could barely see that it was them. It had to be pointed out to me by a Pentagon official who they were. The Secretary of Defense, although initially ran to the scene, apparently, of the tragedy, and actually assisted getting some people onto stretchers, was then brought back to the National Military Command Center in the bowels of the Pentagon.
27. And leaders from Great Britain.
That means the cockpit voice recorder may be easily recovered.
If they do get that cockpit voice recorder, immediately authorities will start to listen to that tape, and they may know a great deal about who was in the cockpit, what the motives were, what the methods were, and it may go a long way towards explaining these terrorist attacks. Of course, the questions about security will go on for some time, but for now, an entire nation is trying to deal with an unprecedented attack on this country. Our chief Washington correspondent, Bob Schieffer, has been downtown all day monitoring the reaction in Washington. Bob?
And I must put a rumor to rest. There were rumors that an Air Force F-16 actually shot down that jet. Pentagon officials have said categorically that is not the case. There may have been an explosion aboard that jet before it crashed, but there was no U.S. Air Force plane involved in shooting down that airliner, which, as you say, appeared to have been headed for Camp David, perhaps out of Pittsburgh.
All right, Jim Mikuláševski. Jim, thank you very much under very difficult circumstances. Thank you, Mick.
All right, obviously, Bob Hager is NBC's expert on aviation. He joins us now. Bob, I have a couple of questions for you. First of all, we know that some people or a couple of people on board the planes that were hijacked did manage to get cell phone calls to people on the ground. Do we know if there was any communication between the cockpit crew of those flights and any ground control personnel?
We don't. They would be able to press a button in the cockpit and indicate that they were being hijacked, send out a special code. We don't know if they managed to get off any actual audio transmissions of any of this. But there's a picture of the actual plane hitting the World Trade Center, the South Tower. That's the United flight that came out of Boston. It had 65 people aboard. That was the second crash of the day. It came just 17 minutes after the first crash. You were asking about cell phone accounts. I want to treat this very carefully. It's unconfirmed information. There is an unconfirmed report that an American Airlines flight attendant was on a cell phone with her operations people describing some of what went on in one of these flights, the flight that went down in rural Pennsylvania, and that she said that the crew had been shot. And then a flight attendant was stabbed in the aisle of the plane, and then they lost contact with her before this reached its culmination in the crash. Now, again, that's an unconfirmed report. American Airlines has not confirmed it. It comes from an American Airlines source, but again, it's unconfirmed through official channels at American Airlines. It's not hard to imagine in this day and age that several people of different passengers and or crew may have been able to make cell phone calls, because that frequently happens with disabled planes in this day and age. All traffic has been grounded in the U.S. That's the first time that that has ever happened in history. It was called as of 9:30 this morning, planes that were in the air.
Well, madmen in the world, as much as you try. And I frankly would have thought that this was not a credible threat to have four separate people decide to commit suicide in the same way on the same morning.
Why not?
Because ending your own life is not something the average person does. You know, everybody's assuming these are Islamic terrorists. Well, if so, they've defiled their own religion. You know, Islam does not permit suicide. It says you go to hell if you do something like this.
But we see suicide bombings in the Middle East and in Israel. And
Judy, we saw people in Northern Ireland, Catholics acting like savages and Protestants acting like savages. So anyhow, we have people who call themselves Muslims acting like savages. It happens. It's not because of their religion. It's because they're fools.
What does this say now? I mean, you've done a lot of reporting. I mean, you not only write fiction, you do a lot of reporting from inside the intelligence community, inside the military.
I can't hear you. I can hear you fine. If you remember, about no more than 20 to 25 minutes ago, we were talking about another building in the World Trade Center that officials here were very worried about, that they thought it might collapse. I referred to it as Building 7, and it used to be just over to the left of that white modern building down there. It literally was poking right above that, probably about a 20 to 25 story building. Moments ago, that building literally gave way and collapsed into the street down there. So that would be the third building in the World Trade Center complex that has collapsed today. That's what all the smoke that you see there now is. It literally is coming all the way up Manhattan here, probably another 10 or 15 blocks, the smoke from that collapse. That was a very large, probably, I'm guessing here, maybe a 20-story building that just collapsed there. As we have been saying all along, the most difficult part for officials here and for rescuers here is when can they go back, when can they start to go in there and investigate who is alive and who is dead. One of the reasons that they have not been able to go in there in large numbers is because they were afraid of exactly that. And no more than an hour and a half ago, we were told by Port Authority officials that they were afraid that there was another building in the complex. We later learned it was Building 7, the one we showed you a half hour ago. And just moments ago, that building collapsed. Matt?
Pat Dawson, hi, it's Katie. I was just curious, are there any other buildings in danger of collapsing in that general vicinity?
When we spoke to the Port Authority officials, as I said, probably in the last hour and a half, they indicated that they were worried about a couple of buildings, but really they concentrated on Building 7. That is the one that just fell.
Trying to judge how long it would have taken somebody on the 80th floor of the tower to get out of the building before it collapsed.
Now, a lot of people passed me because I'm a big guy, so I wanted to walk slowly going down 32 flights. It took me about 20 minutes because they already had the doors locked down on where I had to get out.
Richard, also, if I can jump in, just so people understand who was in the world.
Osama bin Laden, because of the level of logistics necessary to carry out today's series of attacks. Bin Laden is a millionaire Saudi businessman believed to be living in exile in Afghanistan. U.S. officials link bin Laden to numerous terrorist attacks, including last year's bombing of the USS Cole in Yemen. He was blamed for the 1998 bombings of the U.S. embassies in Kenya and Tanzania, in which 224 people died. And one of his top lieutenants was convicted this year of plotting to bomb the Los Angeles International Airport at the turn of the millennium. An Arab journalist with access to bin Laden told Reuters that the guerrilla leader had warned just 3 weeks ago of a, quote, unprecedented attack on U.S. interests. Since 1998, he has declared all U.S. citizens legitimate targets of attack. The tall, thin bin Laden's goal, in his own words, is to unite all Muslims and establish a government which follows Islamic law. His network supports terrorists in Afghanistan, Bosnia, Chechnya, Somalia, Yemen, and Kosovo. We should note, though, that just hours after the attacks, Afghanistan's hardline Taliban rulers condemned them, rejecting suggestions that bin Laden is behind them.
Meanwhile, NBC's Andrea Mitchell is at the State Department this afternoon. Andrea, what are State Department officials saying about the possibility that this is the man responsible for these attacks?
Usually they are very cautious about drawing these conclusions. Since the State Department was evacuated, Katie, I'm here in our newsroom and talking to national security officials, intelligence officials, and others in the government. They now believe that bin Laden was responsible. They have seen some evidence since the attack this morning pinning this on those involved with bin Laden's organization, a global organization that George Tenet has been warning Congress is the one organization capable of multiple attacks with no warning. This is his MO. This is the way he, according to the indictment and the arrest warrant, was able to attack both the embassy in Tanzania and in Nairobi, Kenya, almost simultaneously. It is a requirement of a great deal of coordination, of money, of expertise, a global terror network, if you will, which has been almost unique to bin Laden. So while he was immediately under suspicion, we are now told from top U.S. officials that they have seen evidence, which we can presume is some sort of electronic eavesdropping evidence, that in fact bin Laden was in some way responsible for this. That is certainly their operational theory. And regarding Hoda's report, the Taliban leaders of Afghanistan would be well advised to deny any complicity because they've been harboring him within weeks. Only weeks ago, U.S. officials warned the Taliban that if anything happened to the U.S., they would hold the Taliban, the leaders of Afghanistan, personally responsible. So if there is going to be a retaliation, based on the evidence that they are now indicating to us here at NBC News, you can bet that that retaliation will most likely be against Afghanistan. Katie?
Andrew, of course, many people are asking the question, why now, why today? And I thought it was interesting when I read this afternoon that in June, a U.S. judge had set tomorrow as the sentencing date for a bin Laden associate for his role in the 98 bombing of that U.S. embassy in Tanzania that killed 213 people. The sentencing had been set for the federal courthouse near the World Trade Center, but the sentencing had been postponed some time ago without being rescheduled. Has anybody commented on the fact that the sentencing was scheduled for tomorrow?
Well, it is the sentencing. There are other facts. There is a case in Los Angeles right now involving a bin Laden associate who had been involved in allegedly masterminding one of the Millennium bombing plots that was foiled. And there have been intelligence successes. There was also a threat during that millennial period that bin Laden was involved in trying to organize attacks on three tourist locations in Jordan that are frequented by Americans, and an attack that was planned, according to the FBI, on a U.S. destroyer in the area of Yemen, all foiled around the time of the millennium. But as you well know, Katie, only 6 months later, terrorists did ram the USS Cole in October of last year, killing 17 U.S. sailors. And afterwards, recently in June, bin Laden on a home video, a training video, a remarkable piece of tape, took credit for killing sailors and issued this tape, which was a recruitment tape for more people to target America. One of the things that we should point out here, as you've just suggested, is that there is a long history between the U.S. and bin Laden, although he was never indicted for his involvement.
Happened this morning, but unfortunately on this particular piece of tape, and one of the pieces of tape you're about to see, some of the language is strong. So if we can roll that videotape now or as soon as possible. One of the Trade Center buildings has been hit at a high floor, maybe above floor 90. By one aircraft. That would be American Flight 11. Now look at the plane coming in the middle. Oh, what a picture.
Jesus fucking Christ!
Don't touch it.
Oh my God!
That plane hit the second building at a much lower level. First plane hit very high up on the one tower. Maybe floor 90 or above. Second plane at what? I don't know, maybe floor
71.
71 and up.
Yeah.
You may want to run that videotape again. This we just got into our newsroom. This videotape. And not long after this, first one and then the other, these towers collapsed. And now we've had building 7 of the World Trade Center, where Solomon Brothers Smith Barney had their headquarters.
Holy fuck!
Oh my God! Oh my God! Jesus fucking Christ!
Don't touch it.
Oh my God!
A ball of flame envelops the second of the World Trade Center towers.
Oh no!
Oh my God!
Oh my God!
Untold death and destruction. As after being hit by the second plane, the second tower eventually collapsed after the, you know, both of these twin towers collapsed. Now building 7 in the World Trade Center, after being evacuated, we're told, collapsed. In the debris below, people still trapped. This is new videotape that had not been seen before. Dateline Washington, the Pentagon now says, and we've checked and double-checked this, 100 people believed killed or injured. There's no differentiation. We still don't know how many killed, how many injured.
For Americans who had, I guess, enjoyed some sense of security, thinking that perhaps Osama bin Laden and his organizers and compatriots were operating in other places, it appears that this had to have been organized, at least with great help, inside our own borders.
Matt, that's probably one of the most worrying aspects of this, because it has been an article of faith among U.S. counterintelligence people that operating inside the United States was something that was difficult, maybe even impossible. Among the other things that came down today, along with those buildings, were those preconceptions. We now know that he has been able...
This is the latest new video we have. You see the plane coming in high speed, aiming for the mid-level, and hits it.
Pierces the heart of a city and a nation.
That was the second flight, United Flight 175, and this is the reverse side of the building. See, the plane actually pierced the building.
There were several angles.
Virtually came out the other side. Yet another view, the plane hitting.
It's almost like the building swallowed the plane.
Yeah. Yes. And here you see this aircraft below. Did you see that? Mm. You had to be looking closely in the right-hand side to see it hitting there. And indeed, Russ Mitchell said it's almost as if the building swallowed the plane and then belched back up. Well, nobody's ever seen photographs like that because nothing like this has ever happened before.
Of those people actually jumping off those towers.
Yes, I think the thing that was most harrowing, we tend to ignore common sense. I was about three blocks away. The first building had already been hit. The second building had just been hit. The impact of the second building, of the plane coming from the second building, came from the south. So to me, from where I stood, it looked like a massive explosion. I continued to see people actually go in both directions, oddly enough. I think people were evacuating all buildings. I was actually at that time trying to get to work and basically stood and watched, a bit like a deer in the headlights, the people evacuating. The fire was tremendous in the first building, the northmost tower. And people could not escape, I think, the heat. They continued to go up, it appears. And there were an enormous number of people that that jumped from the building.
So you're talking about people jumping from above probably the 80th or 90th floor. And we've had reports that some people were actually leaving windows in the building holding hands.
They were jumping in pairs. They were jumping. It was raining people. It was amazing to see, and while you think you should turn away and escape, I think everybody was just frozen and watching. There was a lot of crying. I think a lot of people were extremely disturbed, but very few people left the scene. The other thing that was quite disturbing, I think no one, including myself, questioned the integrity and the strength of both the buildings that collapsed. Most of the police were there. They responded quickly and tried to make way for EMS and paramedics and others to get close to the building. And I think a lot of people were in fact trapped when the first building collapsed. I had then moved north towards the Travelers Building, 388 right. Greenwich, and at that point it was spooky and just escaped the first collapse.
All right. Harry Crosby. Harry, thank you.
Afghanistan, where information is very hard to come by and the facts are always few, and information rarely pure and never simple in Afghanistan, explosions are reported near Kabul, Afghanistan. We'll be monitoring that situation as we go along here. I thought we had another piece of information, but not so. Now, let me pause, take a breath. Those are the facts, the central facts as we know them. Want to show you the best available pictures we have of the situation, this attack on America. That at least was the plan. Let me pause and take some instructions. If there are other instructions, I'm not going to that video. Now's the time to tell me in the control room. If so, then let's go to the video. All right, we're going to replay those pictures. Stay with us here, folks. This is live television, not always the neatest. Look at this aircraft, the speed with one World Trade Center has already been hit. This plane is coming in, midsection hit. And then opposite side view. You can see that plane go in and it pierced, you know, seemingly all the way through the building. This was the second building hit. That plane believed to be United Flight 175. Another view from another side. You can see how far some of the debris was immediately thrown. Now both buildings are smoking ruins, people desperately trying to get out. This is yet another picture of the plane hitting. Some of this video we did not have available this morning. Now, whether any of this is connected with events in the United States today. Now, the Taliban, the radical and fundamentalist Muslim group in control of most of Afghanistan, has repeatedly refused to help the United States bring Osama bin Laden to justice, and Osama bin Laden, at last report, was being hidden in Afghanistan. The Taliban's position, which they stated today, was that we don't have any evidence that Osama bin Laden's been doing anything. And the Taliban leadership today, early in the day, this was their words, another pretty big explosion there in Kabul. Well, let me break off and let's listen to this reporter.
Us hearing the detonation at the hotel is about the same duration, so I am using that as an estimate to gauge that those missiles again are falling in the area of the airport. First, we're seeing the flash, and then we hear the detonation some several seconds afterwards, and they appear to be coming from that airport area, in some cases several miles away from it.
This reporter is saying that missiles have indeed struck Kabul, Afghanistan. We have no independent confirmation of that, but the reporter on scene, Mr. Robertson, says
President Bush, to his government, to the American people, for this terrible act. We are completely shocked, unbelievable.
In the West Bank, a spokesman for the Democratic Front for the Liberation of Palestine, or DFLP, a radical PLO faction, denied his group was involved in the attacks.
The DFLP has no relation to this accident or this incident. We have always been against terroristic actions, against civilian targets, and especially outside the occupied territory.
At Jerusalem's Damascus Gate, some Palestinian men, women, and children took to the streets in celebration after hearing of the events in the United States. In Lebanon, at a Palestinian refugee camp, there were more celebrations as men fired their weapons in the air.
President Bush vowed to find and punish the people behind the terrorist attacks. Here is what he said, and in a separate statement, the reaction of Secretary of State Colin Powell.
Just before noon, Secretary of State Colin Powell spoke from Lima, Peru, where he cut short his first official visit to South America. Before leaving, he thanked foreign ministers for adopting a message condemning terrorism.
A terrible, terrible tragedy has befallen my nation, but it has befallen all the nations of this region, all the nations of the world, and befallen all those who believe in democracy. Once again, we see terrorism, we see terrorists, people who don't believe in democracy, people who believe that with the destruction of buildings, with the murder of people, they can somehow achieve a political purpose. They can destroy buildings, they can kill people, and we will be saddened by this tragedy, but they will never be allowed to kill the spirit of democracy. They cannot destroy our society. They cannot destroy our belief in the democratic way. You can be sure that America will deal with this tragedy in a way that brings those responsible to justice. You can be sure that as terrible a day as this is for us, we will get through it because we are a strong nation, a nation that believes in itself.
A short time later, President Bush spoke to reporters at Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana. He'd flown there following his education event in Florida.
Freedom itself was attacked this morning by a faceless coward. And freedom will be defended. I want to reassure the American people that the full resources of the federal government are working to assist local authorities to save lives.
Apparent that some of the rescue workers in the first wave that went to the first building were killed with the second blast. Now, as for what's happening in Afghanistan, if you're saying to yourself, what about these pictures we're seeing from Afghanistan? We simply don't know what the situation is in Afghanistan, and we are being cautious, skeptical about information. Yes, there's at least one news organization reporting that American missiles have struck Kabul, Afghanistan, but we do not know that to be a fact. What we do know that there have been a series
before allowing any motorists to enter the base.
As you can see from behind me, there's 100% identification checks going on at the gate, so there may be delays of people trying to enter the installation.
The base is only open for official business until further notice. No one else will be granted access. Even though Valdosta officials say that the city is in no danger of attack, All law enforcement are on standby just in case the military asks for their assistance.
If Moody Air Force Base were to request assistance from the city of Valdosta, the police department, certainly we would, you know, do what we can to help them without degrading our capabilities to providing law enforcement protection for the city of Valdosta.
Security measures are definitely on the rise, and the military is prepared for what's next.
This is just a very tragic world event, and our hearts go out to all those involved.
That's Michelle Dinkong reporting this afternoon from Valdosta. Certainly those with family members who are serving in the military, there is concern about what
television was on. And that is the astonishing second one, as seen by a freelance cameraman who joined us a short while ago. And he then stayed on to record this extraordinary, which we've seen from many angles, collapse of first one of the trade towers and then of the other. And the attack brought down these two towers upon themselves, ultimately, and has left this extraordinary pile of rubble. Video brought to us from yet another person. Meanwhile, we have this crash at the Pentagon, 200 feet wide. Concern at the White House, obviously. The president was in Florida early today, but then, particularly when word that a fourth plane had been hijacked, which ultimately crashed in the Pennsylvania countryside outside Johnstown, Pennsylvania, not far from Pittsburgh. The President of the United States has spent part of this day in an underground bunker in Nebraska. He's on his way back to Washington now. He's going to speak to the nation tonight. The Navy's Atlantic Fleet was at one point diverted to come and bring aircraft carriers to New York Harbor so that they could assist. There's help and assistance descending on New York and Washington from a variety of places. And it's probably not at all unfair to say that the entire country is, in some measure, in shock as to what has happened.
Building number 7 collapsed, a 42-story building, weakened by the devastation that had occurred earlier today. No word on any casualties in the building. It was the one calamity that was not a surprise. Police had evacuated the area hours ago, fearful building number 7 would indeed fall down.
Track this one aircraft as it was headed towards New York City.
Plane took off about 8 o'clock out of Logan in Boston on its way to Los Angeles, climbed to 29,000 feet and cruising at about 450 knots. About that time, 8:28, the flight took an immediate hard left turn due south. The speed initially decreased by over 100 miles an hour and then increased to over 500. And then as it approached the New York area, it slowed to all the way down to about 300 knots. So and then tragically it impacted in the World Trade Center. American 11 was indeed the first flight, we have confirmed that, of the two.
But as ABC's Charlie Gibson.
These heinous acts of violence are an assault on the security of our nation. They're an assault on the security and the freedom of every American citizen. We will not tolerate such acts. We will expend every effort and devote all the necessary resources to bring the people responsible for these acts, these crimes, to justice. Now is the time for us to come together as a nation to offer our support, our prayers for victims and for their families, for the rescue workers, for law enforcement officials, for every one of us that has been changed forever by this horrible tragedy. The following is a summary of the known facts surrounding today's incidents. American Airlines Flight 11 departed Boston for Los Angeles, hijacked by suspects armed with knives. This plane crashed into the World Trade Center. United Airlines Flight 175 departed Boston for Los Angeles, was hijacked and crashed into the World Trade Center. American Airlines Flight 77 departed Washington Dulles for Los Angeles, was hijacked and crashed into the Pentagon. United Airlines Flight 93 departed Newark for San Francisco, was hijacked and crashed in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. Crime scenes have been established by the federal authorities in New York, in Washington, D.C. area, in Pittsburgh, in Boston, and in Newark. The full resources of the Department of Justice, including the Federal Bureau of Investigation, the Immigration and Naturalization Service, the U.S. Attorney's Offices, the U.S. Marshals Service, the Bureau of Prisons, the Drug Enforcement Administration, and the Office of Justice Programs are being deployed to investigate these crimes and to assist survivors and victim families. Thousands of FBI agents in all of the field offices across the country and in the international LEGAT offices, assisted by personnel from other Department of Justice agencies.
The firemen were very
deadly terrorist acts. The victims were in airplanes or in their offices, secretaries, businessmen and women, military and federal workers, moms and dads, friends and neighbors. Thousands of lives were suddenly ended by evil, despicable acts of terror. The pictures of airplanes flying into buildings, fires burning, huge structures collapsing, have filled us with disbelief, terrible sadness, and a quiet, unyielding anger. These acts of mass murder were intended to frighten our nation into chaos and retreat. But they have failed. Our country is strong. A great people has been moved to defend a great nation. Terrorist attacks can shake the foundations of our biggest buildings, but they cannot touch the foundation of America. These acts shatter steel, but they cannot dent the steel of American resolve. America was targeted for attack because we're the brightest beacon for freedom and opportunity in the world, and no one will keep that light from shining. Today, our nation saw evil, the very worst of human nature. And we responded with the best of America, with the daring of our rescue workers, with the caring for strangers and neighbors who came to give blood and help in any way they could. Immediately following the first attack, I implemented our government's emergency response plans. Our military is powerful, and it's prepared. Our emergency teams are working in New York City and Washington, D.C. to help with local rescue efforts. Our first priority is to get help to those who have been injured and to take every precaution to protect our citizens at home and around the world from further attacks. The functions of our government continue without interruption. Federal agencies in Washington, which had to be evacuated today, are reopening for essential personnel tonight and will be open for business tomorrow. Our financial institutions remain strong, and the American economy will be open for business as well. The search is underway for those who are behind these evil acts. I've directed the full resources of our intelligence and law enforcement communities to find those responsible and to bring them to justice. We will make no distinction between the terrorists who committed these acts and those who harbor them. I appreciate so very much the members of Congress who have joined me in strongly condemning these attacks. And on behalf of the American people, I thank the many world leaders who have called to offer their condolences and assistance. America and our friends and allies join with all those who want peace and security in the world. And we stand together to win the war against terrorism. Tonight, I ask for your prayers for all those who grieve, for the children whose worlds have been shattered, for all whose sense of safety and security has been threatened. And I pray they will be comforted by a power greater than any of us, spoken through the ages in Psalm 23. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. This is a day when all Americans from every walk of life unite in our resolve for justice and peace. America has stood down enemies before, and we will do so this time. None of us will ever forget this day, yet we go forward to defend freedom and all that is good and just in our world. Thank you. Good night. And God bless America.
The President.
WCBS News Time 8:48. It's traffic and weather together. Tom Kaminsky, Chopper 880.
All right, Pat, we are just currently getting a look at the World Trade Center. We have something that has happened here at the World Trade Center.
And within half an hour, became America's second Pearl Harbor.
Freedom itself was attacked this morning by a faceless coward, and freedom will be defended.
By now, you've seen the pictures, but it's been a long, agonizing, and confusing 12 hours.
Oh, it was chaos. It's something out of a movie.
So, briefly, here's what we know about exactly what happened. 8:48 a.m., American Airlines Flight 11, hijacked en route from Boston to Los Angeles, slams into the North Tower of the World Trade Center, two-thirds of the way up the 110-story building.
We had seen a fireball, and I can tell you it appears as though something has gone into the World Trade Center.
20 minutes later, at 9:08 a.m., a United Airlines flight, number 175, also from Boston to Los Angeles, tips its wings and crashes into the South Tower.
Oh, my God! Oh, my God!
An incredible fireball, so remarkable, it didn't even seem real.
Looked like a plane rammed into the second building.
35 minutes after that, 9:43 a.m., American Airlines Flight 77, scheduled to fly to Los Angeles from Dulles Airport outside Washington, dives into the Pentagon, destroying one of the building's five sides.
I happened to hear a plane come through. It sounded like it was running normal.
10:10 a.m., the fourth hijacked plane, United 93 from Newark to San Francisco, crashes in a remote area 80 miles southeast of Pittsburgh.
Just come down like it was going to land, but instead of landing, it just went nose right into the ground.
In a little more than an hour, four horrific plane crashes, hundreds believed dead. But far worse was yet to come. Oh, 10:05 a.m., the South Tower of the World Trade Center, possibly weakened beyond hope by the plane's impact, collapses. People can be seen jumping from the high floors.
The building came just rumbling down. It was like a war zone.
10:28 a.m., and the North Tower, choked with smoke and flames from its upper floors, disintegrates. Smoke and ash from the destruction combined to make parts of New York City look like ancient Pompeii after the eruption of Mount Vesuvius. Rescue firemen were coated with thick white dust.
This is terrible. We lost tons of guys. We lost tons of guys.
Cars were under blankets of ash. Rescuers were just happy to be alive. As for the death toll, even tonight there were no hard numbers. But New York Mayor Rudolph Giuliani feared it might extend into the thousands. Half a world away, there was a far different reaction. Gunmen appearing to applaud today's terrorism. But Palestine Liberation Organization leader Yasser Arafat did not join in.
We are completely shocked,
In Afghanistan, a spokesman for the ruling Taliban, who provides sanctuary for terrorist leader Osama bin Laden, said he could not have been behind the attacks.
Everybody out!
Back home, it was as if war had been declared.
Ordered that the full resources of the federal government go to help the victims and their families.
President Bush spoke to the nation, first briefly in Florida, and later from a military base in Louisiana.
The resolve of our great nation is being tested. But make no mistake, we will show the world that we will pass this test. God bless.
Then, heading to another military base outside Omaha.
The Air Force being evacuated, they need to go home.
All international flights into the U.S. were diverted to Canada. The FAA stopped every single commercial airplane flight for the first time ever. And terrorism experts made it a point to remind everyone that tomorrow had been set as a sentencing date for an associate of Osama bin Laden for his role in the 1988 bombing of the American embassy in Tanzania. That sentencing had been set for a federal courthouse near the World Trade Center. As the day ended in New York City, another skyscraper in the World Trade Center complex crumbled, building number 7, 47 stories high. And tonight, while smoke from the collapse of the Twin Towers still lingered over New York City, most who saw and survived this day still had trouble believing what they saw. The phrase you heard over and over again was, it seemed just like a movie.
Rush Mitchell. In Washington, the nerve center of the U.S. military sustained its own swift attack. David Martin, our national security correspondent, has details about what happened at the Pentagon and how the
Bin Laden likely deployed more than 50 terrorists on or about the 23rd of June to carry out these attacks and others when he issued that warning that Jennifer mentioned. The specific warning was, it's time to penetrate America and Israel and hit them where it hurts most. I'm also told that it is likely that the attack that on the aircraft that went down in Pennsylvania, the United flight that launched out of Newark, was probably not Camp David, but was more likely Fort Detrick, which of course has beneath it the National Emergency Military Command Center. And finally, at the Pentagon and at other military command centers, where I've got a lot of friends who used to be in this line of work, there's a lot of talk about these being kamikaze attacks, and hope that tomorrow the president is going to make a request to the Congress for an absolute declaration of war.
But who would that be against?
Well, Osama bin Laden.
Declare a war on somebody. You declare a war on this one man?
Well, in fact, it's been done before. The third president of the United States, with the acquiescence of the fifth Congress, declared war against the Barbary pirates, who were terrorists. And of course, what we have now is the 43rd president, the 107th Congress. And there's absolutely nothing in the Constitution that says you can't declare war against Osama bin Laden. Further to that, it is not only the Taliban who have provided refuge to him, but also, when one looks at it, in neighboring Turkmenistan, this man has been given at least acquiescence, if not refuge. And so I know that people are looking there as well as Afghanistan.
Ollie North, very interesting stuff. Thank you very much. Hope you'll come back. Let's turn now to another.
This, and I would not remove any of the options available to the president.
Floor was evacuated. The 82nd floor was evacuated.
That 2 to 3 other suspects may have come across the border into the U.S. from Canada and flown here yesterday morning from.
Began to tell me that with voodoo dolls and pins and spells and curses, that he had the ability and the power to control people. Now, he believed that. He checked in with a witch every morning by phone in Southern California, by the way, that gave him his, quote, marching orders for the day. But he was as addicted to her as a heroin addict is to drugs. He got her guidance, and he believed that she had absolute knowledge that gave him the power to control other people. And he said in my.
An operations manager came to each one of us. Are you okay? Do you want to be relieved? And I said, no, let me stay. Let me get this cleaned up. We need to get these guys on the ground.
You weren't too rattled?
Not at that moment. It was a sense of urgency. It was a sense of protectiveness. It's the same protectiveness we work these planes with every day of the year. But daggone it, nobody was going to take any more. Not if we could help it.
According to FAA radar records, almost 5,000 aircraft, the green dots, were safely guided to the ground in under 2 hours, leaving behind a nationwide coverage of blue dots. Those are military jet fighters.
The air traffic controllers achieved the impossible, and it was something that had never been contemplated, something that had never been practiced, and yet they did it with professionalism and skill. I'm very proud of them.
Since then, Danielle O'Brien has gone to the actual scene to see for herself what happened.
I've been down to the Pentagon and stood on the hillside and imagined where, according to what I saw on the radar, that flight would have come. And I think that they came eastbound, and because the sun was in their eyes that morning, and because the White House was beyond a grove of trees, I think they couldn't see it. I think they couldn't see it. It was too fast. They came over that Pentagon, or saw it just in front of them. You can't miss the Pentagon. It's so telltale by its shape and its size. And they said, look, there it is, take that. Get that. They certainly could have had the White House
if they had seen it.
In the days after September 11th, Danielle struggled hard to deal with what had happened, turning to family and then close friends for support.
I called a girlfriend of mine that evening, and I got her answering machine. And I said, you're not gonna believe what I've been involved with today. And I said, you know, American 77, I saw him, I saw it all. Call me. And Tuesday evening lapsed and Wednesday lapsed, and I hadn't heard from her, which was very odd. And then Thursday she called, and she sounded different on the phone. She said, did I understand your message right? And I said, yes, it was just, it was amazing. And I started just blurting out everything. And she said, Danielle, she said, Bob was at work that day. My husband was at work that day in the Pentagon, and he's missing. Last week I went to his funeral. It's real personal. This one?
Danielle is now taking some time off to spend with her family. She has yet to tell her two children, Kennedy and Garrett, what their mother actually experienced that day.
Kennedy, do you like this one?
And so how are you doing?
I think like the rest of the nation, I have good days and bad days.
Are there bad dreams or nightmares?
Sure, absolutely. I've sat up straight in bed many nights, reliving it, re-seeing it, rehearing it. The one that comes to mind most, dreaming of the green pool in front of me. That was part of the radar scope. It was a pool of gel, and I reached into the radar scope to stop that flight. But in the dream, I didn't harm the plane. I just held it in my hand. And somehow that stopped everything.
Oh, Brian, would that she could have.
Indeed.
You know, the plane that the brave passengers took down in Pennsylvania, do we know now where that plane was heading?
The theory is that plane was bound for the U.S. Capitol and that this flight, American 77, was supposed to hit the White House, the terrorist 1-2 punch in Washington.
Just as they had done in New York.
Exactly.
You've been on top of the anthrax story, Brian.
Yes.
What's the latest?
The latest is that today the Postmaster General said he can no longer guarantee the safety of the U.S. mail. Just a handful of powder has paralyzed the mail system, stretched law enforcement way too thin, and terrorized the country.
But we're still looking for clues.
Urgently looking for clues all over the country right now.
We'll be talking about that. Thank you, Brian. And we'll be right back.
When 2020 returns.
Would you be surprised if there's an arrest in the anthrax cases based on photo evidence?
Next.